Please stand for the alumni, student, and academic processions and remain standing for the national anthem and the placing of the mace.
Thank you. Please remain standing for the singing of our national anthem and the placing of the mace. Thank you. You may be seated. Mr. Acting Chancellor, would you please convene our convocation ceremonies today?
Ladies and gentlemen, convocation is now in session. As Acting Chancellor, it is a pleasure to welcome you to the Ivey Business School Convocation at Western University. This year, we celebrate 93 years of business education at Western. The Ivey Master of Science in Management program was established in 2010, the Executive MBA program in 1991, and the MBA program in 1948. Accordingly, we salute the class of 2016, which represents the 5th MSc class, the 22nd Executive MBA class, and the 67th MBA class to inherit the school's proud tradition. Graduation represents a major milestone in your lives. At Convocation, we assemble as a university community to celebrate and recognize your achievements and to wish you every success for the future. Your learning days are far from over. Learning is a lifelong process. Western and Ivey have not provided you with all the answers or all the questions. At most, we hope that what stays with you is a way of thinking objectively, approaching problems with an open mind and a healthy respect for new ideas. All this tempered with compassion and empathy for the human condition. You are forever a cherished member of this great university founded more than a century ago. We welcome you into the Western and Ivey families. I offer my congratulations to each and every one of you. I would also like to acknowledge and thank the parents, spouses, partners, children, relatives, and friends of our graduates who are here today. This celebration would not have been possible without your loving support. I ask that our graduating students please rise, turn around and face your family and friends, and give them a round of applause for supporting your journey. Today, we confer an honorary degree upon Mr. Jon Love. To present our distinguished candidate, I now call upon Dean Kennedy.
He's soon to be Dr. Love, not yet. So it's my pleasure to spend a few minutes telling you about our honorary degree recipient today, John Edward Love. John's an exceptional business person. Among his many accomplishments, he's the founder and managing partner of Kingset Capital, which is Canada's leading private equity real estate investment firm. He was formerly president and chief executive officer of Oxford Properties from 1992 to 2001. He's also one of Canada's most generous philanthropists. His support for numerous healthcare and educational institutions, including Ivey, has helped improve the lives of countless Canadians. John established a fund at the Toronto Community Foundation with his wife and fellow HBA alumnus, Nancy Yeomans Love, who's here today. Among their many charitable contributions, John and Nancy donated $1 million to the Princess Margaret Hospital Foundation to support a chair in prostate cancer research. He's also a very generous donor to many other notable causes in Canada and across Canada and in Toronto. But today I'd like to focus on the family's extraordinary legacy here at the Ivey Business School. Not only did both John and Nancy graduate from our HBA program, but their daughter Christy graduated from Ivey's MBA program, and Christy's husband, Jeffrey Thomas, is an HBA graduate as well. For close to two decades, John has been one of Ivey's most engaged alumni and strongest supporters. In 1998, he joined the Ivey Advisory Board. He currently serves on the board's executive committee, a group that provides me with valuable advice and counsel. In 2001, John and Nancy established an HBA scholarship to help support students with financial need. In 2006, John became a member of the Ivey's Toronto Campus Task Force, where the EMBA takes place. He was instrumental in launching Ivey's Tangerine Leadership Center, and the Love Family Foyer at the Toronto campus is named in their honor. In 2008, John joined the volunteer cabinet for Ivey's Campaign for Leadership, a fundraising effort that raised more than $206 million to support the school. As part of that campaign, John led the new building task force and was a driving force in planning, development, and funding our beautiful new building. As a member of Ivey's campaign cabinet, John assisted in securing a number of key gifts to the building. In total, John and his family have personally committed over $3.75 million to the school, including $3.25 million specifically to the building. The Love Family Quadrangle, which is in the center, the beautiful area in the center, is named in the family's honor and has become an important place to meet, study, and relax. John sums up his support for Ivey in these words: "I believe in Ivey and its ability to create leaders for Canadian and global businesses. Clearly, Ivey's ambitions call for a world-class facility." I would add that Ivey has benefited from the generosity of a world-class alumnus. John's career has helped fuel the Canadian economy through job creation and business growth. In his private life, he's helped improve the social welfare of countless Canadians. He's here today as a living example of Ivey's mission. He's a business leader who thinks globally, acts strategically, and contributes to the many societies in which he lives and works. Mr. Chancellor, on behalf of the Vice Chancellor and in the name of the Senate, I ask you to confer the degree of Doctor of Laws, honoris causa, upon John Edward Love, an exceptional Canadian business leader, passionate philanthropist, and exemplary alumnus.
By virtue of the authority vested in me as Acting Chancellor, I admit you to the degree Doctor of Laws, honoris causa. Congratulations, Dr. Love.
You don't do this every day.
So,
you guys will have your chance.
Not so fast, Dr. Love. On behalf of all assembled here today, I would now like to invite Dr. Jon Love to address Convocation.
I'll start by thanking Dean Kennedy for that most gracious introduction. Acting Chancellor Capone, Dean Kennedy, faculty members, the 2016 graduating class, proud family, and supportive friends, I am humbled to receive this honorary doctorate at my alma mater and to address you today at this convocation. As I look out this morning, I'm reminded of 40 years ago, 40 years and 3 days ago to be exact, when I was sitting in this same auditorium, eagerly awaiting my turn to walk the stage, to graduate, to turn to my life's next chapter. I was sitting next to a classmate, Nancy, my then girlfriend, my now wife of 39 years. As I look out today, She is it. I was not going to do this. As I look out today, she is there again, this time sitting with our two children, Christy and Jason, and their spouses, Jeff and Samantha, the parents of our five grandchildren. I look no farther to see my most important legacy. In my professional life, I've had the opportunity to lead two tremendous teams to build industry-leading businesses, Oxford Properties and now Kingset Capital. With Nancy, our community involvement has ranged widely, funding scholarships, research chairs, innovation programs, and seeking to help those less fortunate. I was delighted to chair the new building, the new Ivey Building Task Force, where we were charged with overseeing the design and development for the new building that you have all experienced. A world-class learning environment looking to the next 50 years. And so, I'm here today. As I thought of what I might say this morning, I wanted to give you one takeaway, one big idea to think about. So I'll share my view on the single most important differentiator that drives success as a person, in business, and in life. You're all bright with strong IQs, otherwise you would not be here. But intelligence is a base attribute and not the one thing that can differentiate you. You have survived the rigors of Ivey's case study method, learning to think, advocate, work as teams, and deal with uncertainty, all key elements of the real world that make Ivey so superior to textbook teaching in a world of Google and Wikipedia. But these alone are also not the key. In my experience, both my personal experience as well as watching others, some successful and some not so, the common trait of most all successful people is the same. It's not IQ. It's not just EQ. It's adherence to strong values. Now, some of you may be rolling your eyes. You're all thinking that you get it. You all know you have values. But let's unpack what I'm talking about. That actually wasn't the funniest line. In my view, but that's good. In my view, values have four critical components. First is respect. Respect of others. It's all too easy to dismiss an idea different than ours when perhaps more listening was warranted. God gave us two ears and one mouth for a reason. And when you're listening, really listening, you're respecting the other person. And respect is for everyone. Spouse, family, friends, coworkers, customers, suppliers, etc. Thank a service provider and look them in the eye when you do so. Reach out to a friend or colleague who has lost a job or personal relationship and show care and respect. Show up on time. In fact, be 5 minutes early. If you respect my time, you respect me. Never be the last one to show up for anything. And respect people's differences. When I started leasing office space in my 30s, in my 20s, I was told we wanted $8.50 a foot and to ask for $9. So I went to my first small tenant, 500 square feet. I said $9. He said $8. I said, I'll split the difference, $8.50. He said, done. Second tenant, I said $9. He said $7.75. Thinking on my feet, I said, I'll split the difference, $8.50. He said, done. By now, I think I'm a genius. I go to the third tenant, and I say $9. And the third tenant was the largest tenant in the building, been there 35 years. Went to the third tenant, I said $9. He said, fine. I've got a problem. He was not a negotiator, so I ended up negotiating him down to $8.50. So then I went to the fourth tenant, and he said, what's the rate? I said $8.50. And he said $7.50. I said, let me tell you my story. And I've told that story lots of times. Respect is a cornerstone of behavior that underpins your family and your personal relationships. Those that show respect will get respect. So the second of the four is humility. If someone has to tell me how smart they are, I assume it is because I would not otherwise know. If someone has to tell me the scale of their possessions, I assume it is because it is their only redeeming feature. Humility can be the key to resolving a tough situation. In the early 90s, when real estate markets were at their most challenging, We got to a point where at Oxford we could not make an interest payment on a mortgage. I was terrified. I set a meeting with a senior lender, went to see him, explained our predicament, offered some ideas, some solutions, some options, apologized, etc. And when I left, he stopped at the door and said, thanks. And I said, thanks? He said, well, John, let me tell you, there's three kinds of borrowers. First kind are people that borrow money and pay it back. We like them the most. Second kind are the people that borrow money and then they don't tell us the truth, they obfuscate, they hurt our collateral and so on. We go out of our way to hurt them. By now I'm a little tense. The third kind is someone that has a problem and comes and talks to us and is transparent, humble, has solutions and ideas. With those people, we work with them and we'll work with you. Humility and transparency built that relationship. Let results speak for themselves. It's much louder. Third is integrity. Do what you say and say what you mean. You often hear the mantra, under promise and over deliver. And that sounds good in theory, but I'm not sure Nancy would have married me if I under promised in my proposal. And I can assure you that I've never won an important business deal by under promising. This one is simple. Over-deliver, do better, add something extra, be creative, do it all with transparency and trustworthiness. You want to be known as the one most likely to do the right thing. In life, one gets exposed to many temptations, and it can be a very slippery slope. Accounting irregularities grew to consume a culture and created Enron. The push for environmental compliance, conflicting with increasing performance standards, exposed institutional acceptance of cheating at Volkswagen. The use of performance-enhancing drugs has escalated at the Olympic level to threaten the Games. 20 years ago, I was working on a major law firm office lease, down to 3 points. We met on a Sunday night. We settled all three, shook hands. We had a deal. I got it done. Monday morning, I wrote it up and realized I'd made a mistake, a big mistake. I called my father for advice. Always a good decision. And his advice was sound. I called the senior partner of the law firm, told him we would stand by the handshake, but I'd made a mistake. Once he understood, he told me that because I was prepared to honor the deal, that he would make the change to fix the mistake, and the deal was made. And they're still our tenants today. The relationship continues. And the fourth is relationships, as nothing is more valuable in your personal and professional life than what bonds us to one another. A relationship, defined, is an exchange of value. Not monetary value, but real value. Love, friendship, help, humor, support, guidance are some of the currency of relationships and what makes them and keeps them alive. Ask yourself this. When you recognize the sender of an inbound text, email, or call, do you rush to answer it? Or ignore it? Is your first reaction positive energy or negative energy? As you think about the relationships around you, do this phone test and do some remedial work where required. My wife Nancy is chair of the MS Research Foundation, which means we do some strategic fundraising. Just a couple months ago, I approached a long-term strategic partner of Oxford and Kingset, where subsequently Nancy and I made the pitch to have them donate $1 million to the campaign. Quite a big ask. A week later, the CEO came to my office, sat down, explained how important our relationship was to them, and said instead of $1 million, they agreed to donate 1.25. The relationship was so important, they wanted to exceed our expectations. For me, life's greatest wealth is relationships. My wife and family who sustain me, my business relationships that have allowed me to lead and build businesses, and my friends who know me for who I am and love me anyway. So there it is. From my experience, the secret to a successful life is adherence to deeply felt values. Respect of others, humility of self, integrity, and building relationships. Today, you will all be participating in the Ivey Ring Ceremony. Do more than just show up. Think about it. Think about it, what it can mean to you. Think about when you were talking and perhaps should have been listening. Think about when you underdelivered, regardless of the promise. And think about the phone test. Think about what you can learn from these experiences, as those that can learn can evolve to do great things. And as you leave Ivey, reflect on your time here, who you might reach out to and thank, who made a difference for you. And a final thought, you also need to dare to dream, and dream big. You are on the doorstep of such exciting possibilities. I wish you every success in life and in your careers, and I hope at least one of you has the opportunity 40 years from now to come back here to share what you have learned with the class of 2056. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Love, for sharing your values of respect, humility, integrity, and relationships with us today. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me once again in thanking our latest alumni, Honors of Doctorate Law, Dr. Love. Graduates, this is your day. This is a celebration to honor you and your accomplishments. Today, we formally mark the end of one stage in your development and the beginning of the next. Will the Masters of Science and Masters of Business Administration class of 2016 please stand? Mr. Acting Chancellor, I am honored to present to you the candidates who have successfully completed the MSc in Management program and MBA program at the Ivey Business School at Western. I ask that you admit them to the degree of Masters of Science in Management and to the degree of Masters of Business Administration, which they have been recommended by the Senate of our university.
Under the authority vested in me by the Senate, you will be admitted to the degrees as shall be announced by the public orators.
Will the class please be seated? Now, as we all recognize, today is a special day for families and friends of our graduates. As a member of the operations faculty, I am uniquely aware of the challenge of bottlenecks and the impact that they have on running a smooth operations. So let me explain the process to you. Graduates will cross the stage two at a time and in alphabetical order. We'll begin with the MSc students, followed by the MBA students, and then finally the executive MBA students. Guests, we request that you take photos from your seats. Otherwise, we will have congestion at the front of the auditorium. There will be a professional photographer taking pictures of the graduates as they cross the stage. Western will provide a complimentary photo for each graduate after convocation. There will be ample opportunity after the ceremony to take photos with your graduate. Hooders and ushers, please move to your positions for the hooding of the candidates.
Candidates for the degree of Master of Science in Management: Vince Chen, Alicia Drazek. Bijan Giga, Richard Gold.
Talk about a bottleneck.
Ying Lee, MC Little John. Harsh Malhotra, Li Li Chen. Ubi Umau, Clara Veray Boshen. Liang Yu Shu, Niang Yang. Alan Zhang, Brenda Zhang. Herlene Ahuja.
These are now candidates for the degree of Master of Business Administration. Tom Aitlin, Jacqueline Aldrovandi. Harris Aleem, Mike Alfieri. Media Alamarad, Khalil Amlani, Daryl Anjay, Neeraj Anachatra. Robert Antolin, Mark Ancini. Sunil Bansal, Daniel Bernholtz. Gugan Bhutia, Srijan Bhutacharya. Kunal Biswas, Tom Blackburn. Rachel Bennell, Justine Brilliant. Royden Brousseau, Cario Paul Brown. Sarah Brown, Milagritos Carrasco Castro. Alexandra Sesnick, Brandon Chan. Clemens Chen, Fei Chen. Nikhil Chug, Owen Chung. Justin Cloutier, Max Dalson. Nisha Densigani, Bianca Denise. Eugene Draco, Adam Erickson. Mark Featherstone, Elliot Fenwick. Shade Ferhatovic. Dylan Fettis. Jeremy Finkelstein, Matthew Fong. Zach Ford, Kyle Fraser. Charles Fung. Dipali Goyal. Anoop Gopalan, Daniel Gordon. Sid Goyal, Alana Green. Anoop Galati, Ewan Gua. Kyle Hartland, Ash Harshim. Helen He, Jan He. Jeff Hodgson, Alex Holliff. Warren Hopwood, Andrea Huitron Moreno. Cynthia Innes, Simon Jim. Yulia Kalashnikova, Jacqueline Kalina. Amit Kapoor, Lisa Kendrick. Manav Kani, Omar Khan. Eric Koh, Ariel Koshitsky. Melanie Koso, Anand Kulkarni. David Kwok, Jonathan Lau. Johan Lee, Jason Lee. Matthew Mahani Mano Majumdar. Alan Mack, Anastasia Makara. Andy Mather, Swati Mata. Graham Matthews, Mark Mallison. Jamie McCall, Brianne McMurray. Mehran Mehta, Sathwik Misra. Alyssa Middleman, Natalie Mittler. Rahim Murji, Praveen Mudmanikam. Akshay Nanjia. Vishwanath Narayanasadmi.
Congratulations.
Aparna Natarajan. Ibtihal Nayan. Riley O'Hara, Victor Oreskovich. Jolan Page, Christina Pan. Brian Posaban, Anshita Rai. Zach Robinson, Christina Rupsing. Anthony Sage, Nadir Samji. Dipin Samuel, Neil Sarah. Amanda Seifred, Mitch Sharma. Ahmed Shahata, Rishi Sheth. Gaurav Shinde, Richard Siu. Julia Sisnett, Courtney Skeen Hamilton. Jesse Slonwhite, Gurjeev Sohi. Sukman Sohi, Michael Soon Cheong. Erica Spear, Angelina Tan. Fahad Tariq, Patrick Tong. Ritwik Uben, Gord Eckhart. Mauricio Valderrama, Kartik Varma. Kelsey Wallace, Ying Wan. Ruby Wu, Emma Xu. Daniel Yanowski, Henry Ye. James Zhang, Kiki Zhu. Your convocation program lists students receiving academic honors. Students who attain grades in the top 25% of the class are noted as Dean's Honor List. Our congratulations to those students on such an outstanding achievement. We would also like to recognize the recipient of the Supply Chain Management Association Award. This award is given to the student who was enrolled in the Supply Chain Management course, who exhibited excellent academic achievement, and who intends to pursue a career in supply chain management. Our congratulations to Peter Spence, who is a recipient of the award. Peter is not present today and will receive his award later. We also recognize today students receiving gold medals. The gold medals are presented to the two students who achieved the highest average in our MBA and accelerated MBA programs. Our congratulations to Mark Featherstona, who receives the gold medal in the MBA program, and to Kyle Hartland, who receives the gold medal in the accelerated MBA program. Mark and Kyle, would you come forward to accept the gold medals from the dean?
Candidates for the degree of Master of Business Administration, Mohammed Abul Hassan, Subi Al Sayed. Shane Joseph Ayers, Inca Barry. George Bizios Shashank Bomaganti. Dennis Borisenko Gregory Brown. Tatiana Borilova, David Maxwell Bushnell. Jeffrey Carr, Paul Bernard Carroll. George Carter, Stefan Kaya. Ramandeep Chahal, Carolyn Denton. Michelle Dodonkin, Edmund Eldebs. Ted Endian, Jeffrey David Erickson. Kevin Farr, Robert Ferris. Stephen Forcier, Raymond G. John Geraghty, Heather Hyde. Lisa Hyde, Nadia Ibrahim. Esther Ingleton, Syed Afan. Erica Jasmesian, Namita Joshi. Peter Kendall, Ivan Gotchubai. Nigel Marsh, Jennifer Masters. Marianne O'Leary, Frederick Omo Rugby. Michelle DeVoit Parker, Jordan Phillips. Roy Kwan, Muhammad Amin Ratnani. Janet Claudia Rodas. Corey William Todd Sorchuk. Catherine Ann Scarrow, Angelo Schiaffone. Neil Shah, Scott Shee. Birgit Takar, Rosemary Torelli. Francois Trofim Breuer, Regan Patrick Watts. Ian Robert Weinberg. I would like to take the opportunity to acknowledge those students in the Executive MBA program in the top 10% of the class demonstrating top academic excellence. Those students are noted in the Convocation program as Ivey Scholars. Congratulations to you all on this wonderful achievement. Mr. Acting Chancellor, in the name of the Senate, I ask that you grant to the Dean of the Ivey Business School the authority to confer degrees to those candidates whose names appear in the official program but who are not present today.
In the name of the Senate, I grant to you, Mr. Dean, the authority to confer the degrees to those candidates who are absent today.
The next part of our program today is the Ivy Ring Tradition Ceremony. With me on stage are the program directors, Lynn Purdy, EMBA, Andreas Schotter, MSc Program Director, and myself, David Wood, MBA Program Director. I'd like to extend a special welcome to the distinguished alumni who are with us today to be part of this ceremony. These are men and women who believe in Ivy, who believe in you, our 2016 graduating class, and who believe in and participate who believe in and practice the highest standards of ethical behavior and moral leadership. We are very fortunate to have such an outstanding group of leaders together to pay honor to your accomplishments, and we're also here to welcome you into the Ivy alumni family. These graduates are sitting in the front row center. Please join me in expressing our appreciation to our alumni. Our next speaker is a man who's been involved with and supported Ivy for many years. Gary West retired in 2001 after a successful career in a number of senior management positions at the Royal Bank. He moved from Toronto to London to do something different in the second half and is committed to working with communities and volunteer groups. Here at Ivy, he is a member of the Ivy Alumni Network Board and has been a regular contributor to the HBA orientation, judging in the BCG case competitions, and at numerous Ivy Ring Tradition ceremonies as an alumni witness to the Ivy Pledge. Over the years, Gary has been heavily involved on several boards in London, including Western Alumni Association, Foundation Western, the United Way of London and Middlesex, the Victoria Order of Nurses of London Middlesex, and served on the Senate for Western for 4 years. He is currently a member of the Honorary Degree Committee and the Alumni Awards of Merit Committee at Western, a member of the Ethics Committee at St. Joseph's Healthcare Center, and represents the Board of Governors of Western as a community partner at Western District Fair. Gary is an HBA 1968 graduate, a fellow in the Institute of Canadian Bankers, and a chartered professional accountant. The Ivy Ring tradition is one that is very close to his heart, as witnessed by his participation many times since the beginning in 2004. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Gary West.
Thank you, David. Good morning. It's my pleasure to welcome each of you to this important event where you, the graduating classes, become full members of the Ivy Alumni Network. Prior to 2004, the Ivy Alumni Network Board of Directors had been looking for a way to formalize the school's commitment to the highest standards of personal integrity and to create a symbol of pride amongst Ivy alumni. To that end, the Ivy Pledge and the Ivy Ring Tradition were developed. A brand is the sum of our collective experiences, or of its collective experiences. The brand and reputation of the alumni and the school depends on our actions. Reputation and credibility, both personally and professionally, take a lifetime to build and nurture, but can easily be destroyed in seconds. The Ivy Alumni Network has built onto the ring tradition, creating a set of four expectations for alumni. However, like in business, this is not a one-way street. Value accrues in both directions. It is appropriate to ask what you can expect for your investment. Each expectation yields its own reward. So firstly, uphold Ivey principles. Recognize, uphold, and honor the letter and spirit of the Ivey Ring Tradition Pledge. The return? Ivey grads the world over will earn a reputation for good business and strong ethics, a reputation which will benefit each of you in an ever more complex and changing business world. Secondly, think Ivey first. We ask you to consider conducting business with colleagues within our Ivey family. Choose Ivey as your source as a continuing education forum. Encourage your organization to recruit Ivey graduates. This reward is more tangible. You are an Ivey grad, and when other alums think Ivey first, there will be benefits, including career and business opportunities within the Ivey family. Thirdly, remember, you are an ambassador of the school. Promote Ivey within your social and business circles. Help recruit promising Ivey students and recommend Ivey for business education. Most importantly, help promote the school for what it is, one of the best business schools in the world. It can only benefit you to be visually associated with a top business school and for that school to continue to enhance its reputation. Finally, give back. Contribute to Ivey's continued success to the best of your ability. There are many ways to give back. Giving back can be participation in alumni events, identifying and communing opportunities for case studies, making a charitable donation to the school, or helping the students who will follow in your footsteps. And I also strongly encourage you to get involved in the alumni network and chapter activities. You will benefit from being connected to the alumni, and you will help to build and leave a lasting legacy for the school. The Ivey Network is one of the most important ways to connect with business leaders around the world, but it begins with you. You have learned the value of team here at Ivey. Now I encourage you to put it into practice in your everyday life. The school will benefit, yes, but more importantly, you will find that there are direct and indirect rewards for living the expectations. The ring should be worn as a symbol of your commitment to uphold the honor and spirit of the Ivey Ring tradition. So on behalf of the Ivey Alumni Network, I congratulate each of you on your achievement today. I know you will continue to make us proud. Thank you.
Thank you, Gary, for sharing your personal perspectives and for being such an outstanding exemplar of what the Ivey Ring Ceremony represents. And now, we've arrived at the heart of the Ivey Ring Tradition Ceremony, the time when each of our graduating students will take the Ivey Pledge and receive his or her ring. Graduates, please listen carefully to the following instructions. As already mentioned, I'm a member of the operations faculty, so following the process is equally important here. In your diploma folder is a copy of the Ivey Ring Pledge and an Ivey Pen. Upon my instructions, but not until I say so, I would ask you to open the folder and remove the Ivey Ring Pledge. Dean Kennedy will lead the pledge. He will read the first paragraph, and everyone will repeat that paragraph back in unison. We will then read the rest of the paragraphs together. In the first paragraph, you will notice a place for you to say your name. Please state your name. There is no need to repeat Dean Kennedy's name. After the reading of the Ivey Ring Pledge, please sign both copies of the ring pledge and place them back in the folder. Your Ivey ring is in the folder, and you may put it on after the recitation of the pledge. For those graduates today who are also graduates of our undergraduate program and have already received your ring, you are welcome to join your classmates in the reciting of the pledge. Graduates, you may now open the folder and remove the Ivey pledge. Distinguished alumni, please stand and face our graduates for the reading of the Ivey pledge. Graduates, please stand and face the distinguished alumni for the reading of the Ivey Pledge. I now invite Dean Kennedy to recite the pledge with you.
OK,
Okay, so as we said, I'll do the first one, you read it back, and then all together. So I, Bob Kennedy, standing before my mentors and my peers, commit myself to venerate the traditions, reputation, and integrity of the practice of business. Okay, all together. I accept entry into an exclusive network of Ivey Business School alumni. I acknowledge the responsibilities and value the benefits of being a member of such an association. I will, to the best of my ability, act honorably and ethically in all my dealings, in the belief and knowledge that doing so will lead to a greater good. I will express my ideas and opinions openly and without reservation, so long as they do not impinge on the rights and freedoms of others, whoever they may be. I will endeavor to act with moral clarity, grace, and nobility. I understand that I am now a member of a distinguished community. I will strive to uphold the standing of the community with special obligation placed on encouraging and championing the pursuits of my fellow members. I will acknowledge my limitations and my mistakes so that I may learn from them. I will continue to seek new knowledge, never resting on past wisdom or successes. Above all, I will aspire to make a positive contribution to my society. I promise to uphold the traditions, integrity, and high standards set by those alumni who came before me. I promise this to myself, my family, my fellow alumni, and my school. I accept this pledge freely and upon my honor. Congratulations.
You may be seated. On behalf of the Ivey Business School, our congratulations to each of you. At this time, I would like to thank the organization responsible for making the Ivey Ring tradition a reality. To the Ivey Alumni Network Board of Directors, we thank you for your vision, which has been fulfilled here today. Without their support and their belief in what the Ivey Ring tradition ceremony stands for, we would not be here. Graduates, I know you will remember the pledge you have made here today, and will continue to live a personal and professional life that you and the Ivey community will be proud of. Our next speaker is the MBA valedictorian, who was elected by the students to represent the MBA graduating class. For our executive MBA students, your valedictorian spoke at dinner last night. For our MSc students, your valedictorian will speak at our MSc reception during autumn convocation. Now, it gives me great pleasure to introduce you to your valedictorian, Graham Matthews. Thirteen years ago this month, I traveled from Toronto to Vancouver Islands to work on a farm for the summer. The farmer's name was Don Candy. He was in his 60s. He was energetic, enthusiastic. He had lived a really curious life, but he didn't talk about that much. One afternoon, I was sawing fence posts. And Don wandered by and paused, and he asked me a really simple question. He asked me where my mind was when I was sawing wood. I thought about it. I answered it as best I could. I guess I was watching my line, making sure I was cutting straight and on course. And Don seemed to think this was fine. He sort of nodded, but he suggested that instead, I put my attention to the point of action, where the blade is actually touching the wood. I thought this was great, right? Farmer Don telling me, in a metaphor about sawing wood, how to live life more in the moment. But I saw a practical problem with this. If I were focused on the point of action, how would I know if I was cutting in a straight line? Now, Don had an answer for this. He said, every once in a while, just stop cutting, check your line, look at what you've cut, look at what you're about to cut, and then return the saw and your attention to the point of action. Well, this was a great Yoda moment for me, I think.
this beautiful illustration on living a mindful life, right? Taking moments to be reflective, but then always returning your attention and your awareness to the point of action. And I remember that afternoon vividly to this day, and I thought about it a lot this past year. And today is one of those reflective moments for us. We're gathered here in this room to celebrate a distinct accomplishment, for sure. And we're surrounded by our supporters and each other, and as others have mentioned, marking the end of one chapter and the beginning of a new one. So I propose we try out Farmer Don's technique right here, right now, and pause, and step back, and reflect at where we've come from and what lies ahead, and then, and only then, pick up our saws and go back to work. And it's easiest in many ways to start by looking back. We can imagine previous classes gathered in the same room, nodding and smiling about very similar moments to our own. You know, the first day jitters, the stacks of casebooks, the ambitious filing systems, meeting new friends from all over the world. For many people, it was an entirely new culture, a new country, which I am still in awe of, how you manage that on top of everything else. And then diving right in, assigned seats, sections, early mornings, eager group work, of course, the cornucopias of contribution, regressions and simulations, 24-hour reports, sugar highs, exam anxieties, the beautiful bell curve angels. And then there are other moments that previous classes might understand too, but not really in the same way. For us MBAs, it was endless Facebook invites and tilts, one jars and eggplants, carpools and costumes and concerts, group chats, group dinners, group saunas. I mean, certainly I heard stories of malt Mondays and wine Wednesdays and our share of fantastic Fridays. And then there are other moments for each of us that no one else understands. Right? Moments of success and failure, development, change. Moments that are for you and you alone to appreciate. And so we each have a story made up of all these different types of moments. And these stories weave in and out of each other's, and they interlock and they overlap. We each have our own heroes and villains, ups and downs that we celebrated and suffered through, sometimes very publicly, sometimes very privately. And none of these stories would be the same if it weren't for the people in this room. The friends sitting next to us, the professors, administrators, support team marking the way, the supporters rooting for us, text messages and phone calls, trips to London, sometimes moving here altogether. That's what makes this group and today special. These robes are going to get worn again, right? These seats are going to get filled, but never by the same group of people. And the relationships, shared memories, and the stories contained in this room, that's unique, and that will not be replicated. So now on to the future. It's hard to feel sure about what lies ahead, and I expect very few of us do. I mean, we're living in a time when competing distractions and expectations and priorities are louder than ever. A few years ago, the CEO of Google, who's then Eric Schmidt, suggested that every 2 days, we create as much information as we did from the dawn of civilization until 2003. Every 2 days. Now, that's a lot of content competing for our attention, distracting us, and studies are showing that our attention spans are dwindling. Certainly, we're surrounded by conflicting expectations, expectations we take on from our parents, our partners, our peers, society, advertising, but most of all, the expectations that we place on ourselves. And we might be comfortable in our own skins, but no one is immune to the Facebook highlight reel. And all of this on top of a growing basket of priorities. We still have the survival imperative of our ancestors, but now also today's focus on self-actualization and the pursuit of happiness. So we think we should read more and run more and volunteer more or cook more or play the guitar more, on and on. Everyone in this room can finish the sentence, I should be spending more time doing blank. But there is no one answer, right? That's the fun of it all. So as we go forward, the best we can do is be aware of all this noise around us, and with the support of our loved ones and our friends, try to be true to ourselves. But if we need help sorting through the clutter, we can remember that more than any other factor, quality social connections lead to health and happiness. And that practicing mindfulness and compassion towards ourselves and towards others is proven to be an excellent return on investment. And that according to palliative care nurses, the number one deathbed regret is that we live a life that others expect of us rather than having the courage to live a life true to ourselves. With that, we can return to the present. Here we are, gathered in this room. On Monday, we return to our lives, our plans, routines, our pastimes. Hopefully, we all find moments of flow where we're lost in what we're doing, challenged to stretch our skills and thriving and jiving in our occupations and ourselves. And hopefully, we also find moments to let our minds wander, be creative, be playful. At any given moment, thoughts and feelings and emotions rushing into us, sometimes surprising us, flowing through us. We always can remember that while we may not control our emotions all the time, we do control our reactions. So if the path of least resistance feels wrong, we can ask ourselves why and respond accordingly. And if we're kept up at night with a knot in our stomach, we can ask ourselves why and respond accordingly. Remember that we decide whether to live the life that others expect of us or to live a life true to ourselves. So let's get out there, get weird, find our flow. Let's keep the stories from this year alive, but help each other write new ones. Let's be mindful and compassionate towards others, but remember to be mindful and compassionate towards ourselves too. And let's be aware and attentive of the moment, but every once in a while, pause, step back, and reflect at how far we've come and what lies ahead. On behalf of the MBA class of 2016, thank you to everyone who makes this group what it is, to everyone here today, and all those who can't be with us. Thank you.
Thank you, Graham, for that moment to stop and pause and reflect. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me one more time in thanking Graham. All right, before we have our concluding remarks, I'd like to tell you about what will happen next. At the end of the ceremony, the Esquire Bedell will lead the academic procession off the stage. All will stand while the academic procession leaves the stage. Distinguished alumni, after the academic procession has left the auditorium, an usher will lead you to the diploma hallway where you will leave your regalia. You may then proceed to the main foyer. Graduates, after the academic procession has left the auditorium, you will follow the distinguished alumni to the diploma hallway, at which you will leave the signed copy of the school's Ivey pledge with our staff. You may keep the student copy for your files. After you have left the school's copy of the pledge in the diploma table, please follow the hallway to the front of the alumni hall, where you will meet your guests. You and your guests may then go to Ivey for class photos. We will be taking photos of each of the MSc, MBA, and EMBA classes on the Ivey staircase in the Grand Hall. Please keep your gowns for the class photos. After the photos are finished, you may join your families in the Brock Pavilion for the reception. Please remember to return your regalia to classroom 1120 in Ivy by 2 o'clock. Executive MBA graduates, if you need transportation back to the hotel, a bus will be leaving Ivey at 2 p.m. Please meet the bus at the north end entrance to Ivey. Once again, thank you for celebrating the special day with us. Mr. Acting Chancellor, would you please close our convocation ceremonies?
Before closing convocation, I wish to express my appreciation to all those who have contributed to the success of this day. In particular, I would like to thank the Chris Murphy Big Band for their performance. May I request that the audience remain in their seats until the academic and graduate processions have exited from the auditorium. Convocation is now adjourned. Thank you.
Thank you.